Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
Thank you. Thank you much. Well, while you're standing, let's pray. Father, we're so thankful to you tonight. We thank you for Jesus and thank you for your word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. And Lord, thank you for one another. We're so glad to be a part of your family. And Father, we just thank you tonight because the Holy Spirit is here and he has free course to move, to minister, to teach, and to inspire. And Father, we believe that he's going to make a difference in our life tonight and that he's going to reveal the Word of God to us. Help us to know you better and love you more and walk with you better. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You can go ahead and be seated. Pastor Jim and Deborah, as always, thank you. What a privilege it is to be in this church. I was just in Detroit last weekend, and I was having coffee with a pastor, and Pastor Jim's name came up, and he said, oh, tell Pastor Jim how much we appreciate him. I don't think you've ever met this pastor, but he heard Pastor Jim's CD on altar calls a few years ago, and he said, we do altar calls just like Pastor Jim does. And it was Saturday night, and they'd had their Saturday night. He said, we just had 18 people saved tonight. And he said we get around 15 people saved every service, you know, on the average. And so I'll tell you, the influence of the Rock goes way beyond the Inland Empire. But thank God for what it's doing here, and also thank God for what is happening everywhere else as well. I want to share with you tonight. You can open your Bibles to Romans chapter 6, and I don't think we're going to go anywhere except that one chapter. But I am so excited about what we're going to be sharing about tonight because it's a message that I first heard. I'll go ahead and tell you. I got this idea for this sermon in 1980 in Australia. And my wife and I had just launched into ministry. It was our very first trip, our very first endeavor. And we ended up with this ministry down there. We spent 7 weeks traveling. And that pastor had some handouts, and one of his handouts was called Knowing, Reckoning, and Yielding. And he had this outline from Romans chapter 6. And so I'm going to, is that stealing, Pastor Jim? That is stealing? Okay, well, then, but it's for a good cause. All right. But I'm going to borrow that, how many of you know you don't have to think up everything yourself? Sometimes it's better to borrow somebody else's brain. And this is something that he had seen in Scripture, just three really powerful points. And, you know, to really understand and appreciate Romans 6, you need to read all the chapters before it and all the chapters after it, but we're just going to zero in. But as Paul gets ready to jump into what we call the sixth chapter of Romans, he's coming out, obviously, of the fifth chapter, and he's made some really incredible statements in Romans 5. Like in verse 17, he says that those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life through Jesus Christ. How many of you have experienced that to some degree in your life? You've received the abundance of grace. You've received the gift of, isn't it good to be righteous? And when you say you're righteous, man, you're not bragging on yourself because you didn't do that to yourself. You didn't do that for yourself. We are righteous. We are in right standing with God because of a gift that we have that somebody purchased for us. We'll talk about that later. But those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life. Isn't it better to reign in life than to just get beat up and downtrodden and, you know, without hope and without help? And it's good to reign in life. It's good to have royalty traits working in your life where God's life and nature is lifting you up. And then a little bit later in Romans, he said that where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. And what that means is that where you had a problem, God had a bigger answer. Where you had a difficulty, God had a bigger solution. Where you had a big mess, God had a great deliverance for you. Where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. And we come to Romans chapter 6, verse 1. And you know, Paul was always thinking about, it's one thing to have a belief, but what do you do with the belief? How do you apply the belief? And he realized that because he had just said, where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. And Paul knew that probably in the future there would be some goofy person who would look at that verse, where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. And they would probably look at that in some kind of convoluted and distorted way and say, well, if that's the case, if we really want a lot of grace, then we need to sin a whole lot. Because where sin does abound, grace does much more. So if you want a lot of grace, you got to do a lot of sin. How many of you know somebody's always looking at something in some weird, distorted way? So Paul goes ahead and precludes that argument. And he says, what shall we say then? Romans 6:1, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And he answers that hypothetical, certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? And then he goes on to give us an illustration about baptism. And, you know, how many of you here have been water baptized? Let me see your hand. You've been water baptized. How many of you got water baptized right out here in the, the fountain area? How many of you got baptized out here? And he goes on to give an illustration about baptism. And he says, essentially, that when you went down into that water, that was representative of being buried in a grave. And that when you came up out of the water, how many of you, when you got baptized, they didn't just put you in the water, but they brought you back out? I'm glad. Don't ever get half baptized. But when they took you into the water, that symbolized that you had died with Christ. And when they brought you up out of the water, that symbolized what? That you had risen with Christ. And so the old life you left in that watery grave, so to speak. Now, Paul goes on and he's going to begin sharing with us through this sixth chapter of Romans, this phenomenal truth about how to really live a new life. Did you find out when you got born again that there was a tendency for some of the old stuff to try to trail along? And how many of you found out that your mind could still think some of those old thoughts? Anybody find that out? And that your flesh maybe had certain tendencies that it had always had? Anybody find that out? And Paul's going to tell us here how to really get established in this new life in Christ and live as a new creature. And this is what he says in Romans 6:6. He says, knowing, everybody say knowing.
Knowing.
Knowing this. And so we're going to tell you something that we need to know. Knowing this, that our old man, that's our old nature, the person we used to be, our old man was crucified with him or with Christ, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has dominion over him. Now, let's talk about this passage of Scripture. That seems kind of weighty. That seems kind of, you know, theological, and how do we get our minds around this? But the Bible tells us this simple fact, our old man. How many of you are a new creature? Let me see your hand. You're a new creation in Christ. You know that you're born again. If you're a new creature, what happened to the old creature? It was, Paul says, our old man was crucified with Christ. Crucified with Christ. Now, Jesus died, you know, in the neighborhood of 2,000 years ago. You and I weren't even born yet. So how was our old man crucified with Christ? Well, I want you to understand this. When Jesus died on the cross, he wasn't alone. And I'm not talking about the two guys that were one guy on either side of him. What I'm saying is that when Jesus died on the cross, he had nothing to die for. He had never done anything wrong. The Bible says he was the sinless, spotless Son of God. But what happened on the cross is that God took all of our old nature, all of the sin nature, the collective sin of humanity, and basically put it, dumped it on Jesus. So that when Jesus died on the cross, he wasn't dying for himself, he was dying as our substitute. He was taking my punishment and your punishment. He was taking the penalty for all of our sin. Our old man was crucified with Christ. Now, I want to illustrate this, and this individual does not know that I'm going to use him, but Brother Fred, come on up here. Everybody give Fred a hand. I'm not going to tell you that Dan was the one that said I should choose you. I'm not going to tell you that. Brother Fred is a wonderful brother, and he and I are going to illustrate something. And just for a minute, I'm just going to be me and you're going to be you. But I want you to pretend for a minute that Fred and I are somehow joined at the forearms. And let's just pretend there's some kind of magical duct tape or something that, you know, just has bound our arms together. And from this moment forward, we're stuck together. You're never going to have a moment alone by yourself. I'm never going to have a moment alone by myself. Aren't you glad this is just an illustration? And but whatever happens to me happens to him, and vice versa. And let's just say that by some, you know, unusual circumstance, I end up with $50 million. And, you know, because I now have this massive sum of wealth, and of course I'd first of all, you know, pay off the Rock Church, but after that, I'd still have, you know, a sizable amount of money left. So, you know, let's say I just decide to go on the most exotic vacations imaginable. I'm going to go to tropical islands and the fanciest hotels and eat at the finest restaurants and fly in private jets and limousines and all that. So if I do all that, what happens with Fred? He gets everything that I get because we're what? We're stuck together. We're identified is another way to say it. He and I are identified. We're joined together. But it doesn't just work that way. Let's imagine for a moment that Fred, not paying attention, steps off the curb onto a busy street and he gets hit by a truck. Guess what that does for my day? If he gets hit by a truck, guess what? I get hit by a truck. Because we're connected, we're joined together, all right? Now, that's the end of that illustration, aren't you? No, let's see, you can step aside there. That's the end of the illustration. All right, it's over. All right, now, another illustration. All right. Now, this is not Fred anymore, and this is not Tony anymore. This is the human race, and I am, I'll just be Jesus or God, and we've got a new illustration. In the beginning, God created man, you know, Adam and Eve, and they had great fellowship together, right? Until Adam and Eve decided that they didn't want to do things God's way anymore, right? You remember that? You took the fruit and all that. And so essentially what was happening is that even though God had created man for this rich relationship and this rich fellowship, man just basically pushed God away. Go ahead. You can do it. Very good. Push. Thank you. So now God and man are what? They're separated. And then all of mankind, they go down the tubes fast. You know, violence and sin and corruption and, you know, the first kids are murdering each other and disease and wars and plagues and famine and all that, you know, not in very good shape, right? That's the course that mankind went. And God would send prophets and different things, and mankind would basically kill the prophets that God sent and that type of thing. And so God, you know, he kind of established, there was a covenant there, but it really wasn't a complete answer. It set up something for the future, but the covenant that God had set up didn't fully satisfy or fully solve the problem. It was more of a preparatory covenant until one day God becomes a man. And Jesus steps in and begins to interact with the human race. Jesus maintained his purity, but compassion, mercy, healing, deliverance, Jesus began to give the life of God to man, and man began to get glimpses of what it was to be forgiven and what it was to be loved unconditionally and what it was to be accepted. But there's still that issue of sin that caused that separation. And so Jesus did something, and this is what happened on the cross. The Bible says that we've all sinned, we've all come short of the glory of God, and the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And so even though Jesus was the sinless, spotless Son of God, go ahead and put your arm out again. On the cross, what Jesus did, he had become a man. And on the cross, what Jesus did was he once again united himself to mankind. And what happened on the cross was essentially this. Jesus saw the truck coming. Jesus saw the judgment coming that was going to destroy and devastate mankind. And what Jesus did, even though man, none of us were even born yet, but what Jesus did was he stepped in front of humanity, and Jesus took the impact of that oncoming truck. Jesus took the punishment and the penalty. And everything that man's sin involved, Jesus drank that cup and he took the full brunt of it. Now, what happened is 3 days later, now remember, this bond is permanent. So not only Jesus embraced the death on the cross that mankind's sin deserved, but after 3 days and three nights in the tomb, guess what? Jesus was, the Bible says he was quickened. And he was raised. And he was seated in heavenly places. And so when Jesus was raised, guess what? Man got raised. When Jesus was seated in heavenly places, humanity was brought back to a place where we could once again sit with Jesus and fellowship with Jesus and have relationship with God. Okay, that's the end of the illustration. Give Fred a hand. The Bible says, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with Christ. And once Jesus entered into that relationship with man, it's permanent. That's why today you can say, my old man was crucified with Christ. I was buried with Christ in baptism, and I've been raised with Christ to sit with him in heavenly places. And as he is, so am I in this world. Because of that identification that was established. The first thing that you need to know if you're going to live a victorious Christian life is that your old man was crucified with Christ so that the power of sin would be broken over your life. I want you to understand Jesus didn't just take the penalty of sin away, but he broke the power of sin. You don't have to be ruled. You don't have to be dominated. You don't have to say, the devil made me do it. And you don't have to say, I had no choice in the matter. I'm telling you, your old man was crucified with Christ, and the power of sin, the body of sin, has been done away with so that you would no longer be a slave to sin. But that's the first thing. You need to know something. The second thing is found just a few verses later in verse 10, Romans 6, 10. And he's explaining, what does this mean? You know, we hear all the time, well, Jesus died for us. Well, what does that mean? And it says in Romans 6, 10, for the death that he died. How many of you know Jesus died? The death that he died, and I want you to watch this very carefully. The death that he died to sin once. Did you notice that this verse does not say that he died for sin? It says he died to sin. Now, please don't misunderstand me. There's other verses that say Jesus died for our sin. But that's not what this verse says. This verse says he died to sin. And what does the rest of the sentence say? But the life that he lives to God. What does it mean when the Bible says that Jesus died to sin? What does it mean when anybody dies to anything? What does it mean if I say, I used to have a real problem with chocolate chip cookies, and through prayer, a decision, my doctor telling me something, I have now died to chocolate chip cookies. What does it mean if you die to something? It means you separate yourself from it. Death is really just another word, in some ways, it's just another word for separation. Physical death is the separation of the human spirit from the body. If I die to chocolate chip cookies, then that means I once had a relationship with chocolate chip cookies. Because you can't die to something. You can't separate yourself from something that you were never united to. You know, somebody who's never, you know, lived can never die. So before you can die to something, you have to have a connection with it. So when the Bible says that Jesus died to sin, what does that mean? It means he separated himself from sin. Well, when did Jesus ever have any kind of connection to sin at all? On the cross. That's where he took our sins upon himself, right? On the cross, Jesus took the punishment, the penalty, the power of sin. He took it out of the way. He took the impact of it so we would not have to. And then after his, you know, time on the cross and thereafter, the Bible says he died to sin. So in other words, he conquered sin in his death, burial, and resurrection. And then he threw sin off, destroyed the power of it, and said, okay, I'm never going to have anything to do with you again. And what's the next part of the verse say? But the life that he lives unto God. So what is this verse really saying? It's just simply saying this. Jesus has completely severed any dealings with sin. Jesus and sin have nothing in common anymore. Do you believe that? He died to sin, and the life that he now lives unto God. All that is saying is this, Jesus is 100% separated from sin, and he's 100% connected to God. That's what that verse is saying. Now, how many of you can believe that? How many of you believe that Jesus is totally separated from sin and that he's totally united to God? How many of you believe that? I can't imagine somebody who believes the Bible having a problem with that. But let me tell you where the problem comes in. It's in the next verse. Here's the next verse. It says, likewise. Now, do you know what the word likewise means? It means equally, similarly, or in like manner. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Likewise, the word reckon, it means consider yourself or see yourself or think of yourself. Now, you know what we get when we put these two verses together? You need to see yourself dead to sin just as much as Jesus is dead to sin. And you need to see yourself as connected to God as Jesus is connected to God. I say, well, wait a minute, I can see Jesus dead to sin, but I'm not sure I'm as dead to sin as he is. And yeah, I'm connected to God, but I'm not sure I'm as connected to God as he is. The Bible says to see yourself as dead to sin as Jesus is dead to sin. And to see yourself as alive to God as Jesus is alive to God. Now, the reason that's challenging for us is because we have this thing called memory. Not just long-term memory, but short-term memory. How many of you, since what is today, Wednesday, how many of you since Monday morning have done something or said something or thought something that you probably ought not to have done, said, or thought? Let me see your hand. Yeah, I knew it. The Bible says, in many ways we all stumble. Aren't you glad for the blood of Jesus Christ? Aren't you glad for 1 John 1:9? The Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let me tell you, I'm not telling you, and the Bible is not telling you, that you have achieved sinless perfection. I'm not telling you, and the Bible is not telling you, that, you know, once you give your life to Jesus, that you'll never, ever, ever again make a mistake. I'm saying you need to see yourself. The Bible is saying that you, the same way that you see Jesus is dead to sin and alive unto God, you need to see yourself the same way. Likewise, see yourself. Think of yourself, consider yourself dead to sin, just like Jesus is dead to sin. Listen, you and I don't have any business sinning. I know we have. But you know what? The alternative to this, what's the alternative to seeing yourself like Jesus? The alternative is to see yourself as an old, unworthy sinner. You're just a worm of the dust. You're just a dog. You're just an old sinner. When temptation comes your way, how many of you face temptation from time to time? When temptation comes your way and you see yourself as an old, unworthy sinner, dog, worm, if that's how you see yourself, why not just go ahead and sin? Because you're just acting on who you are. If you're just an old, unworthy sinner, dog, worm, then why not go ahead and yield to that temptation? Because you've already formulated an opinion of yourself that you see yourself as, why not just go ahead and do that? But if you all of a sudden see, you know what? My old man was crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. My old man was crucified with Christ. The power of sin, the body of sin has been done away, and I'm a new creature in Christ, and God wants me to begin to see myself being just like Jesus. I know I'm still growing. I know I still have flesh to deal with. I know I'm still getting my mind renewed, but I need to see myself reigning with Christ in heavenly places. I need to see myself as born again, righteous before God, separated from sin based on who Jesus is and what he did. And I need to see myself united. I'm in union with God. So all of a sudden, now I have a reason to say no. If you're going to live a victorious life, number one, you need to know that your old man was crucified with Christ. Number two, you need to see yourself, reckon yourself to be dead to sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. But I'll tell you what, if those are the only two things you do, you've not gone far enough. Because Paul goes on to give us a very, very powerful application. How do we apply this in our life? What do we do? He says in Romans 6:12, therefore, and for those of you that are Bible students, anytime you see the word therefore, pay attention. Because he's telling us, I've just given you some factual information. Now I'm going to tell you what to do with it. I'm going to give you the application. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. Anytime that the Bible says don't let such and such happen, it means you could let that happen. Have you ever known a Christian? I mean, not you, obviously, but some other Christian who actually allowed sin to reign in their mortal body? I know you would never do that, but the guy next to you? He says, don't let sin reign in your mortal body because, you know, even though it's been conquered, you still have a free will. You still have to submit to God and resist the devil. So he says, don't let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in its lusts. And do not present. Everybody say present. Do not present your members. This is talking about the members of your body. As instruments of unrighteousness to sin. But present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Everybody put your hand up in the air, tap your arm. How many of you have flesh here tonight? These are your members, your feet, your hands, your ears, your mouth. These are your members. These are the members of your body. And the Bible says, don't present them, your members, as instruments of unrighteousness, but present them as instruments of righteousness. If I were to ask you the question tonight, is your body good or evil? Is your body good or evil? How many of you would say, my body's good? Let me see your hand. Your body's good. Okay, certainly not a majority, few. How many of you would say, no, Brother Cook, I know what my body's capable of. My body is evil. Let me see your hand. Oh, wow, okay, that's a little bit more. That's still not everybody, though. How many of you would say, this is probably a trick question, and I'm not going to raise my hand? Yeah, that's the majority right there. Is the body good or is the body evil? Well, it's kind of interesting because it sounds like he's giving us a choice of what we're going to do with our bodies. You can present your bodies as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but you also have the option and actually are told to present your members as instruments of righteousness to God. See, I can take this tongue, this mouth of mine, and I can gossip, I can lie about people, I can say hurtful things, and when I do that, I'm allowing sin to reign in my mortal body. I'm told not to do that, but I can do that. If I use this tongue to gossip and to criticize and to lie, etc., what I'm really doing is I'm presenting my members as instruments of unrighteousness. But on the other hand, I can take this same mouth and I can use it to give encouragement. I can tell Fred, man, Fred, you were the best illustration ever. I can tell people I appreciate you, and I can tell people how much God loves them, and I can use my mouth, my members, as an instrument of righteousness unto God. So in a sense, the goodness or the evilness of your body kind of depends on what you choose to do with it. Because it has potential either way, according to the Word of God. Have you ever had a car that had a steering alignment problem? And what happens when you're driving a car with a steering alignment problem? What happens is it doesn't tend to go straight. It tends to go to the left. You know, oncoming traffic is not good for the car to go into oncoming traffic. Or it pulls to the right, you know, toward the ditch. How many of you know that's not good? What you do with your car when it had an alignment problem? Did you decide my car is evil? Must be destroyed. No, what you decided was I've got a car here, but it's got a problem, and the problem is it tends to pull in a direction that I ought not to go. I want to go straight, but it tends to pull one way or the other. And so basically you did two things. Number one, I mean, first of all, until you could get it fixed, what you did was, from the driver's seat, you decided, I'm not going to let this car go where it wants to go. I'm going to make this car go where I want it to go. So what that meant was is that you had to do some counter steering. The steering wheel pulled this way, so you just had to compensate by pulling a little bit harder the other direction. And that's kind of like what our bodies are. How many of you have noticed that the flesh has tendencies sometimes toward things that aren't where God wants you to go and where you ought to go? Anytime, like, your flesh just doesn't want to go to church, Sunday morning, you ever want to go to St. Mattress of the Springs? But there comes a point in time where you have to say, you know what, body, you're going to be my servant. You're not going to be my master. You know, and this is what the Bible says. Don't let sin reign in your body, in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. I want you to know your body, the Bible says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And there is a transformation that happens in the life of a believer when your mind begins to get renewed. And let me tell you, a lot of that are the first two things we talked about. When your mind is renewed, part of that is you're going to know that your old man was crucified with Christ. You're going to know that you're a new creature. And you're also going to begin to see yourself a certain way. You're not going to continue to see yourself through all your past failures, through all your past mistakes. You're going to begin to see yourself in Christ. I'll tell you, in our natural histories, we're all a mess. Do you know the Bible says that if God were to count up and hold our transgressions against us, that no one could stand before Him? But we're in Christ. He took away the punishment. He took away the penalty. He declared us righteous, and we begin to see ourselves that way. We see ourselves just as disconnected from sin as Jesus is, and we see ourselves just as connected to God as Jesus is. That's part of being transformed by the renewing of our mind. But in Romans chapter 12, it also says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies to God. Present your bodies to God, a living sacrifice. The reason you have to present your body to God is because your body typically isn't going to present itself. How many of you know your body is not yet born again? Our spirit man is born again. There's going to come a day, what we call the resurrection, when this mortal shall put on immortality. This corruptible shall put on incorruption. There's going to come a day, friend, when you're going to get a body that you don't have to countersteer against. But in the meantime, Paul said, the flesh lusts against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would do. But I want you to know tonight that your old man was crucified with Christ. I want you to reckon yourself to be dead to sin, but alive to God. And I want you to present yourself to God as someone who is alive from the dead. And I want you to present your members as instruments of righteousness to God. When you do that, that doesn't just involve your physical body. It pertains to everything about you. Your thought life, your checkbook, your social calendar. It means that in the totality of who you are, you've given yourself over to God. And under His influence and under His rule, under His reign in your life. And that's where you're going to find that life that Paul talked about. Those that receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, they will reign in life through Jesus Christ. That's the best way to live. That's the only way to live. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank You tonight for Your precious people, for Your awesome people. And Lord, I thank You for the phenomenal plan that You have for us, that when we were at our absolute worst, You gave us Your absolute best. And Lord, we thank You that where sin abounded in our life, grace has much more abounded. Your goodness is greater than our badness was. And Father, tonight, through Jesus Christ, we have the privilege, we have the honor of standing before You, righteous and cleansed and holy by the blood of the Lord Jesus. We have the privilege of being new creatures, and we have the privilege and the honor of being able to walk in the God kind of life, the life that You have for us, where sin does not have dominion over us, but where we get to reign in life through righteousness in Jesus Christ. And Father, we are so grateful for it. I just wonder how many people here, I'm talking to believers right now at this second, how many believers here would say, you know what, one of these three steps or two of these steps or three of these steps, maybe you've not been presenting your body to God. Maybe you've been letting your body dominate you. Maybe there's a member of your body, maybe you've allowed your tongue to just get out of control, and man, you've been saying some things and you've been dealing with conviction in your heart. You know you've been saying some things you ought not to say. And maybe it's just a matter that you've bought into some of the negativity of the world. Maybe you're not gossiping or lying, but maybe you've just bought into the negativity of the world and you've just been spouting a bunch of unbelief with your mouth, and you need to present your mouth to God, as a member, as an instrument of righteousness. How many of you, let me see your hand all over this place. You want to just take a minute. We're going to pray here in a second. And you just want to take a second and say, God, I want to lay my body before You. Let me see your hand all over this place. You've had some part of your body, some member. And let's just, you take a minute and pray, and let's do this together. Father, in the name of Jesus, You said that we were to glorify You in our body and in our spirit. And Jesus, when You went to the cross, You went to the cross in the entirety and the totality of Your being, Lord, so that You could purchase us and redeem us in the entirety of our being. And Father, this is a group of people here tonight. Lord, we don't want to just play some religious game and say, well, I have a spiritual relationship with God. And the fact of the matter is, we're not bringing our flesh under control. We're not presenting our bodies to You as a living sacrifice that's holy and acceptable. And Father, tonight we just want to give ourselves to You in the entirety of our being. We want to know, we know, Lord, that our old man was crucified. with Christ on the cross. And Lord, we see ourselves just as righteous as Jesus is, not by anything that we have done, but Lord, by what He did. And Father, we present ourselves to You right now as those that are alive from the dead. And Lord, we present our members as instruments of righteousness to You. And Lord, it's so good tonight to know that we're accepted, to know that we're loved, to know that we're forgiven, and to know that Your Spirit is working in us to bring us into total maturity, into Christ-likeness, where sin does not have dominion over us, but where we are under the reign and under the rule of righteousness. We thank You for it, Father. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Hey, before we close, let me just do one thing. Because there may be several people here tonight that there's an other step that you really need to take tonight. What I'm talking about tonight is really about people who've already accepted Jesus and they've already put their faith in God. There's always folks, you know, who have never taken that first step. I know, you know, there was a time in my life where I was raised in church and I mentally believed in God and that type of thing, but I had never given all of my life and all of my heart to Jesus Christ. And I'm so thankful that somebody loved me enough to tell me the truth. Tony, this whole thing that we call Christianity, it's not about how good you can be. It's not about how perfect you can be. It's not about how religious you can be. This thing that we're talking about is what Jesus said when He told a man, He said, you must be born again. And I want you to know tonight, because I love you enough to tell you this, that until we have that moment with God where we surrender our life to Him and receive what He did. See, I want you to know, if you've never been in church a day in your life, if you've never thought about Jesus a moment in your life, He already died for you. But it doesn't become real in your life because God is a gentleman and God is not going to force something on you against your will. You and I have to say yes. You and I have to make a decision to receive the gift. Everybody say the gift.
Yes.
You and I have to make a decision to receive the gift of forgiveness and the gift of eternal life. And you know, there's just a harsh reality in life, and that is that all of us have a certain time that we're going to live on this earth, and there's going to come a certain point in time where your heart's going to stop. My heart is going to stop. And we're going to breathe our last breath on this earth. And the second that we do that, our spirit, the man on the inside of us, is going to one of two places. It's going to heaven or it's going to hell. And I, you know, God doesn't want anybody to die and go to hell, but a lot of people die and go to hell because they reject the gift of forgiveness that comes through Jesus Christ. And if you're here tonight and you've never given Jesus Christ all of your life, all of your heart, in just a minute, we're going to pray. And you're going to have that opportunity to just say, Jesus, I invite You into my life right now. I give You my life. And there may be people here, you've never prayed that prayer. You've never accepted Jesus as your Savior. There also may be people here tonight that you've been running away from God instead of running to God. And this is your night to come home. I don't want a single person in this place to die and miss heaven and spend eternity in hell. And it's so simple because Jesus loves us so much. He died on the cross. He shed His blood. He took the penalty that should have been ours. And He's offering tonight the gift of forgiveness and the gift of eternal life. On the count of three, I'm going to clap my hands. And I want anybody here who has never accepted Jesus before or who has, but you turned away from God, you've been running away from God, and you need to come back, I want you to shoot your hand up real high. And then we're going to have you come. We're going to pray tonight. And God's going to give you a brand new start. Is that awesome or what? On the count of three, if you need Jesus for the very first time, or if you need to rededicate your life to God, I want you to shoot your hand up real high. One, two, three. Let me see your hand all over this place. Thank you. There's one, there's two, there's three, there's four. I'm looking way over here. all over. What about in this center section? People that need Jesus for the very first time, you need to rededicate your life to God. What about in the very back? Ushers, are you helping me? We've had four way back in that back corner on the other side. What about over here? Are there folks that need Jesus over here for the first time? Need to rededicate your life to God? I've seen four hands. Let's all stand up. Those four back here that raised your hand, I want you to slip out of where you're coming, where you are right now, and just meet me down front. We're going to pray together. And I want you to turn to the person beside you. I want you to turn to the person on your left, turn to the person on your right, and say, hey, do you need to go down there tonight? Because if so, I'll walk with you. Just ask the people beside you. Sometimes people just need a little bit of a nudge.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I
Ladies, come on up here. So good to see you guys tonight. God bless you. Good to see you. Thank you for coming. Is there anybody else coming, ushers? Anybody else coming at all? I want every one of you to look at me real quick. You guys have made the most awesome, phenomenal decision of your lives, because what you've decided about tonight doesn't have anything to do about me. I never died for you on a cross. Jesus did. And so I want you to always remember tonight, you didn't come down because of a preacher. You came to this altar tonight because Jesus loves you so much that he died for you. And if you're the only person that had ever committed a sin, he loves you so much he would have died just for you alone. But the good news is, well, I don't know if you call it good news, everybody needs that forgiveness. And so you get to partake of what Jesus did for you. I want you to just lift one hand up to heaven, and I want you to say this out loud. Say it from your heart. Say, dear God, I come to you right now, and I thank you that you love me so much that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for me. I believe tonight that he shed his blood so that I could be forgiven. And he's not dead anymore. He is alive. And Jesus is offering me the gift of forgiveness, the gift of acceptance, and the gift of eternal life. Jesus, I accept you as my Lord, and I accept every gift that you're giving me. And I turn my life away from what it used to be, and I turn my life towards you. And I give you tonight all of my life and all of my heart. Thank you that I'm accepted, that I'm loved, that I'm a child of God, and that tonight you have given me a brand new start. Thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, this is Pastor Joel, and they've got some materials they want to put in your hand tonight and spend just a minute with you. If you'll go follow him, they're going to get those materials to you. God bless you. Let's give them another hand as they go.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.